So none of the E2s survived flight. They weren't designed to survive the flight, unlike the solid booster rockets, which dropped off at a much lower altitude. This E2 never flew. This was pulled off the line after the Columbia tragedy as part of the investigation of what caused that tragedy. So if you looked at this external tank, you'll see at the top there's a whole bunch of foam. That foam was removed as part of that investigation. They all kind of break up into a million little pieces. Some of it would burn up because it's made out of aluminum, which cannot withstand very high temperatures. And what was left would rain down, typically into the Indian Ocean, where there's not a lot of shipping, a lot of people pretty safe. Could. But, you know, we only launched shuttles from Kennedy Space Center. That was the only place that they actually launched. Now, they were planning on launching from Bend here in California, north of Santa Barbara. But in both those locations, they knew exactly where the external tanks were going to drop off and where the particulates and pieces of it would rain down. There wasn't over any population.
So, is there
any
specific locations
that
you launch them?
You can launch rockets from anywhere. But where you launch from makes a big difference in terms of safety. Also, in terms of what type of orbit you achieve. A lot of launches now, commercial launches, take place closer to the equator. Because a lot of satellites need to be in an equatorial type of orbit. And that type of orbit also, because the Earth is turning, you can use that rotation of the Earth to give you more momentum to get into orbit. Right? Vandenberg was chosen because that was more of a polar type of orbit, higher latitudes. And that's a military base. And those kind of flights were going to carry spy satellites. And guess what? Our enemies at the time, the Soviet Union, etc., are at higher latitudes as well. So we wanted spy satellites flying over Russia, right?
Okay. Yeah.
So that's why you would launch from there. Florida was chosen because it's closer to the equator, more appropriate for, you know, for the kind of work that the space shuttle, not military purposes. So where you launch from makes a big difference. It did. It proved what was the cause of the loss of Columbia.
Remember.
If you look at the ET, you notice it's completely coated in foam. That was to keep the cryogenic fuels inside cold. Very cold hydrogen, liquid hydrogen. It's like a big thermos bomb. Well, during launch, from all the vibration, some of that foam would often flake off. That was not uncommon. In fact, if we look up here, we can see some tiles that were damaged by that foam. And it was very common, particularly on this side of the orbiter, on its belly, to get damage in that way from that foam flaking. So, during the Columbia launch, as all launches, they had slow motion video of the launches. And in 2003, when Columbia launched, they knew they had a foam strike. They saw that. They saw a big piece of foam flake off from the forward portion, what's called the bipod area. Hit the wing, not this wing, but the other wing, and hit the leading edge of it. Now, the leading edge is made out of a very different material than the tiles. The tiles are made out of silica, or sand, as I mentioned before. The leading edge of the wing is a material called reinforced carbon-carbon. That's not silica. Reinforced carbon-carbon is very similar to what we call nowadays carbon. We make bicycles and tennis rackets out of carbon fiber, which prices dropped immensely. Back in the 70s, the RCC, though, was very expensive to make. There's 22 panels in each wing. Each panel cost over $1 million. So pretty expensive stuff. And on that video, the launch video, they saw a piece of foam strike the leading edge of the wing. But NASA didn't think at that time that the foam and the ice coming off the external tank could damage the RCC. It's pretty strong material. They were wrong. In fact, what happened was a 1-foot-wide crack opened up in panel number 6 from that foam strike, and they were totally unaware of it. Now, they proved that the ice and foam could damage the RCC material using that foam that they took off of this external tank.
Okay.
They put it into a cannon up in the Northern California, shot it at pieces of the RCC, and created a crack. So that was enough to prove that material could be damaged in that way. And that's why the Columbia was lost, because of that foam.
What about the Fenman? What about the Fenman thing with the O-ring?
That was the Challenger investigation.
That was the Challenger one. Okay.
Now that was a very different scenario. They launched on a very cold morning.
Right.
The previous night it was very cold, and ice had actually formed on the launch pad. The solid booster rockets, which are the two rockets on the side, do most of the lifting during launch. Are actually 6 segments that are connected together. They're segmented like that to make transportation easier. They're assembled in Utah and then barge from Louisiana over to Florida. To put them on that barge, they break them down into these 6 segments. They're like big pipe segments. And then they're reconnected. And to seal those connections, they use rubber O-rings, huge O-rings.
Right.
You can see some of the segments on the other side of the wall there. There's 2 skirts out there which show you how wide those solid booster rockets are. Well, rubber, as we know, gets hard when it's cold. And that was determined to be the cause of the failure. Both O-rings, it was 2 O-rings that sealed each segment. Both O-rings failed because of the cold weather. And when they didn't seal, instead of the propulsion all going down the business end, some of it went sideways, right into the Challenger orbiter and into the external tank, which caused the explosion. I think it was 94 seconds into flight.
Wow, yeah. And it took a long time to find it. I heard Dr. Fenman talking, you know, Richard Fenman, right?
Yeah.
Talking about, and how they wouldn't listen to him for a long time. NASA wouldn't listen to him, right?
Right.
And finally, the story is that he was on a panel, no one would pay attention to him, and he got a guy to bring ice water, and he put an O-ring in the ice water, and finally got to tell the story.
There is an excellent documentary made of that.
Okay.
Dramatization made of that, and they showed that, and it required a complete change in culture at NASA. That was the real culprit here.
I see.
Because in fact, 2 engineers had warned their bosses about launching when there was ice on the launch pad, when it was that cold, fearing, you know, just this, you know, problem.
I see.
But their concerns were not relayed high enough, and the launch was, you know, because of budgetary pressures and pressure from Congress, and, you know, they wanted to get more launches and faster and show more success. They rushed things and they ignored those kind of warnings.
So you'd say the culture is much better now since that time, right?
It was a huge learning experience.
Right.
The same thing happened after Columbia. Was, you know, don't ignore, you know, things just because they haven't happened before. You know,
yeah.
So these are systems run by humans. Humans make errors.
Yeah.
And you need to allow for, you know, human error. You need to allow for systemic error. And
maybe bring people in from the outside who are maybe smarter than you, even though you're not part of their little clique or their clan, right?
Well, you know, there's that tendency, you know, we haven't experienced this before, so it doesn't happen, you know.
Yeah.
It's, you know, that kind of tendency in any organization. And it's, unfortunately, when you're launching rockets and people aboard, the margin for error is very, very, very small.
Well, it's good. You know, you noticed her asking that question. It's a really good question about where these things might land. I mean, let's say North Korea, who's obviously very good at rocketry, decides to just launch whenever they want to, satellites and whatever, and or launch something with that big that comes down in the wrong place on somebody's houses, and maybe they don't care as much as we do when we launch from Cape Canaveral. Is that possible now, do you think, as more technology gets in other people's hands?
Well, I'll give you another example. Not related to North Korea. A few years back, China tested an anti-satellite weapon. And they ended up creating a huge debris field in orbit around the Earth, which is now a real hazard for space travel.
Still there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
because it takes years and decades for that to deorbit. So because they destroyed a satellite, you know, using this anti-satellite weapon,
right?
You know, we now have to track, you know, thousands of little pieces of debris. We've always been doing that, but now we got this, you know, very dense debris field that the space station has to avoid. It's always up there. The space station is. They have to raise and lower its orbit, you know, based upon where debris is.
So if you want to destroy basically the satellite network in the world, all you have to do is put up a bunch of trash, right? Just put up tons and tons of trash,
yep.
And that might just do it.
It would ruin. It would ruin, you know, a lot of capabilities that all nations have now.
Wow.
So you don't want a lot of debris up there.
No, but I mean, you know, you say take some bad country that doesn't like us and technology and all that. That sounds like it's hard to believe, space. But then we've ruined the oceans, right, in a lot of ways. It's possible to put up that much trash, huh?
It is.
Wow, that's scary.
It's something we would have asked, right? It's manageable right now.
That's good.
Those kind of mistakes, you know, made by, you know, China and other nations can have very serious ramifications for our everyday living. I mean, these, you know, cell phones that we use, you know, rely on satellite technology.
That's right. That's right.
GPS, you know, rely.
Banking, everything would just be shut down if you could shut it down.
Exactly.
It sounds like a movie we might have made, right? But it sounds like it's actually physically possible to make a great deal of trouble if nothing else, right?
Exactly.
Wow, that's scary. Thanks a lot for scaring us. All of you gonna have a good night's sleep now? You all right? Thank you very much.
So how does this stop in orbit and go down the path?
Okay, so good question. So when they're in orbit, they're traveling at 17,500 miles per hour, and as long as they maintain that speed, they'll stay in orbit, right? But if you look at the design of the orbiters, they have two big rockets on either end here. We call them the OMES, the orbital maneuvering engines. There's a lot of little rockets spread around. You see these holes here, these ports here, and they're up here. Those are called the action control system. That's for changing the orientation when in orbit. But these big rockets here are for deorbiting. So when it's time to come back from Earth, they want to slow down. They only have to slow down about 200 miles per hour. And to do that, they flip the orbiter around. So those rockets are facing the direction of motion. And they fire those rockets for a minute or two.
Wait a minute.
And that's what slows them down. And then they start dropping back to orbit. You know, people think it's complicated, but it's actually very simple. Simple. It's like firing a cannon. Gunpowder in the cannon, and put a cannonball in there, and point it in a certain direction. If you have enough gunpowder, you'll send that cannonball into orbit. Most of the time, nearly all the time, there's not enough gunpowder, so it falls back to Earth. If you fire enough energy, it'll stay in orbit. Now, the opposite is true, too. If you fire a rocket on that cannonball, you slow it down. It's fairly simple math. You can tell exactly. So, I want you to imagine for a second that you're on ice skates, okay? Let's say this was all ice, okay? And if I pushed you like that, which direction would you go in? You'd go that direction, wouldn't you? Now let me, so if I were to push you, you were on ice skates, you would go that direction. Now let's say, instead of me pushing you, you're on a baseball. You threw that baseball as hard as you could. Which direction would you go? Go in that direction. And that's exactly what the rocket is doing. It's like throwing a baseball. Not pushing against anything. It's producing a force going that direction. And there's a rule in physics that says every force creates an equal and opposite reaction. So if you make a force that goes that way, going to go that way. That's all the rocket is doing. It's not pushing against the ground, pushing against the air. It's simply creating a force going that way. Pretty cool.
yellow frame, is this a support structure?
It was designed to transport the